What's cracking, guys? And today I've got a new video idea for you. This is Liam's terrible movie reviews. Recently on my Twitch channel, I've been watching some videos that have had some absolutely terrible acting in them, and I kind of want to bring that content over to YouTube. So instead of doing like 10-minute videos, I decided let's do a movie. And recently I saw the name of this movie and I was like, this has to be it. Sharks of the Corn by Stephen Kang. Everyone who sees the name has to watch the movie. Like, it's impossible not to. So the format of this video is that I will tell you whether the movie is worth watching. I will then break down the scenes of the movie, the best scenes of the movie, and then I'll give it a little review at the end. If you enjoy this kind of content, like the video, comment, let me know if there's any like really bad videos that I should watch, and really bad movies that I should watch, and let's get into it. So our movie starts out here with Gary and Susan. They're right next to a cornfield. Gary just recently won a corn eating contest at the carnival they were just at, and they decided to, get away. Gary's got a full bottle of vodka, which he's already half the way through. And Susan apparently finds this very attractive because she decides to, let's do some hanky panky in the cornfield. Gary is interested, but continues to swig his vodka. Susan makes her way in as she continues to undress, and throwing the clothes back at Gary as he's stumbling through the cornfield. As she goes through, she comes across this lovely man. This is a scarecrow with the head of a shark and a plaid jacket, and yes, that is a piece of corn in between his legs. That's obviously his penis. She does admire his corn penis, throws one of her clothes on it, and then proceeds to continue on her way. Gary then passes this shark scarecrow and does what any sane person would do and decides to sit on it. Yes, when he sits on it, it does make a pants rip noise. You know this movie's already started out well. Unfortunately for Susan, as she continues to get undressed, she has alerted the sharks that are in the corn, and she's getting hunted down. Unfortunately for her, the shark does catch up and does take her out and kill her. Next scene, we move on to a lovely antagonist here. His name is Teddy. And he's a weird shark guy, is the best way to put it. He's got his little shark shrine there with the shark teeth there. He's very weird. He makes his way down to the lobby where we meet Lorna, who seems to be a lady of the night, as she offers Teddy some drugs through a syringe that has no needle. Apparently that's part of the budget cuts. And then offers him her services, which he gladly accepts. He takes her back to his hotel room, where she, instead of runs away the second she sees a shark shrine in the middle of the room, she decides, oh no, this is kind of cute. Well, this is gonna be a bad choice for you because Teddy, let's put it, beats her over the head with the shark mouth. And this is where I am pro practical effects over visual effects, especially for low budget films, because we have this beautiful work here. This is not safe for work. I don't know who's watching this at work, Aki, but this is not safe for work. Oh wow, I don't even know how you do that with a shark teeth. But yeah, she is killed by Teddy, and Teddy then throws her in the cornfield. Big bummer. Next we move on to later we have Gary here, who has woken up. there, and it's called The Police, with Constable Kramer to his left and a lady in the back. I forget what her name is, but she's just getting caught up in all the police tape. Like, generally, she's getting tied up in that. But Gary's here explaining what he, you know, what happened. You know, he fell asleep in the corn. They were going to get some frisky. And Constable doesn't believe him whatsoever. He immediately thinks that he was trying to get it on with Susan, but she didn't want it, so Gary killed her. I don't know why the constable doesn't like Gary, but yeah, he doesn't believe a word he says and puts him in jail. Next scene we have here is these two thieves. We don't know who they are. They are breaking into a very high security compound, probably government, I'm not sure, but they have to dodge these sorts of, you know, traps, like the swinging, definitely not paper mache, baseball. What the fuck? Somehow they get past it. I don't know how. They made their way to the compound where I think they hire blind guards because they don't get seen here. The guy just walks past. I know, since they, you know, it's literally daytime and they're not wearing camouflage, but you know, they blend in somehow. Make their way into the compound. I use the term compound loosely because it's basically just a large shed where they steal this, I'm going to call it shark juice. It's just like this blue water with, like, I guess a shark embryo inside. Definitely not a shark doll, but yeah, they steal that. They set off an alarm because of course there's an alarm. And then just run straight out. The blind guards decide to check what's missing, despite the fact it would take literally 2 seconds to look inside and realize that the shark juice is gone. The two thieves make it away, and as you would expect, next the compound blows up. You know, that's with some great visual effects here. I think probably done by Sony, I don't know. Next, we have the thieves meet up with this guy. This guy's name's Benchley. He is a CIA operative. I don't think they know that, but he gives them a suitcase full of cash for the shark juice. But Benchley's a shifty one where he now then blow darts them to sleep and takes the money. This is definitely not a metallic straw. It's definitely a CIA blow dart. Next we have Constable Scheider. If she looks familiar, yes, she plays Lorna. They're the same actor, you know. But she's here in the car just chilling out, and someone decides to drive by. Our good old mate Teddy over here, wearing his red ski mask and shark bandana. I don't know why he chose red, but anyway, she thinks this is weird, as any sane person would, and she decides to pull over good old Teddy. Teddy doesn't seem to be the brightest bulb, but he seems to have left all these dead bodies in the back seat. Yeah, that's definitely dead bodies there. Severed heads, not fake at all. Doesn't look like Uncle Fester. The constable is shocked and decides to arrest him, as you would, given the what's in the back seat. She arrests him and takes him back to the precinct. Next here we have Benchley, who's doing another deal for the shark juice. He's going to give them the shark juice for some money. We've got mafia dons here. We're also including little old a kid that's wearing a Beetlejuice outfit. But Benchley doesn't have the juice on him. He only has a map to the juice. So he gives them the map. They give him the money. And then these two to the right go off to get it, basically. is in the cornfield, which isn't a great place. I don't think Benchley knew that there were sharks in the corn at this point in time. He just kind of left it in the cornfield. But yeah, so these two are now in the shark, are in the shark infested cornfield, and promptly get eaten up, as you can see. Oh man, oh, that sucks, man. Like, you nearly had him with the gun. Their cries of terror are heard by the Mafia Don, who says, oh, you double-crossed us. Benchley, well, I didn't actually double-cross you, but, you know, it's too late. Benchley runs away, makes his way to the cornfield quickly to grab the shark juice, and narrowly escapes the shark, because the sharks can't exit the cornfield, obviously. But he gets out. Back at the precinct, definitely looks like a precinct. This is the interrogation room, apparently. Constable Scheider has decided, you know, to interview him. Also gives him milkshake and fries. I don't know if this is actual protocol in this place, but maybe it is. I'm not too sure. I'm not going to judge. But Teddy here confesses to everything, basically telling everyone that he's killed and murdered. One of which was Lorna, the prostitute, who actually turns out to be the constable's sister. So she tells him to tell him where the bodies are, and he tells him that they're in a cornfield, but he won't tell where the cornfield is. He has to go and show her, basically. You know, that old chestnut. Next. Okay, now we're here with Jonathan. Jonathan is Gary's brother. He's come in here to ask the Lieutenant Kramer, or Officer Kramer, I forget. Please release Gary. He hasn't done anything. Why have you got him? Jonathan here, he owns a realtor business in Druid Hills. He also produces a magazine that we actually find out that Kramer was actually featured in the magazine, because he revealed that Kramer had a mistress. This is why the Kramer doesn't actually like Gary and its brother, because they, you know, revealed the truth about his dealings. But Jonathan also wants to tell him that he was flying his drone over the field and saw there were sharks in the corn. Kramer doesn't believe him, though. He says that this could be just shadows of clouds in the sky, or 3D imagery that Jonathan have concocted. You know, Jonathan's magazine is also filled up with like conspiracy theories, and, you know, once he said he saw Sasquatch and all that. So Kramer doesn't believe a word he says. Next, we're back at the precinct. We've got Constable Scheider about to go take Teddy to the cornfields. This is Harry Grossman. This is actually Tim Ritter. This is actually the director to our left. He gives her a bag to take with her that has weaponry. Apparently, he took the bag from a peaceful protester. In air quotes, this movie isn't political whatsoever. And of course, in the bag, she finds a grenade, as you do. Now we move on to a happy family who's deciding to play some good old frisbee right next to the cornfield. You can probably see where this is going. Old mate Dad unfortunately throws the frisbee a little too far into the cornfield, and old mate Billy, yes, it actually is his name, Billy, decides to head in and grab the frisbee. But yeah, the sharks get him. The sharks get him. Unfortunately for him, his family do see this, as we get probably some of the best acting that you've ever seen in this movie. The father and wife are crying as they see the son die. We now move on to a little later. This is their This is Kramer, the woman from earlier. And this is to our right as the mayor, Mayor Zanuck. He is probably one of my favorite characters. He has some of the best lines. One of them being that you're about as useless as like a goat pecker on my head. But yeah, this guy's great. They get told that the family saw that there were sharks in the corn, but they still don't believe him. The mayor thinks that the family's crazy. Jonathan here is here to tell them to get Gary out of jail because Gary was in jail when this happened, so it couldn't be Gary. He then also goes on to show the mayor the overhead of the sharks and the corn. The mayor still doesn't believe him. And then the lady in the back gets a call where some kids have also seen some sharks in the corn. So now that they've heard that, and now they're starting to be like, okay, maybe there are sharks in the corn. You know, I mean, personally, I wouldn't believe that as well until maybe 20 people said it, but yeah. They decide to investigate. Now, we're back here in the car with Constable Scheider, and she bumps into Benchley, who she actually knows. So she knows Benchley, and she says, I'll give you a ride to Druid Hills. He's like, okay, let's go. And old mate Teddy can apparently sense that Benchley has the shark juice in his suitcase. He says he can feel it. As he talks about like there might be a ritual soon, stuff like that. I forgot the mafia guys. So the mafia guys apparently put a GPS tracker in Benchley's little money purse, the thing that they gave the money to. And yes, this guy on the right is wearing what looks to be a microphone on the side of his head. I mean, I don't know how they could ever find a better way to, or a cheaper way to do this. But yeah, they're in a helicopter and he's a micro inside of the head. Whatever. Next, we have good old mate Jonathan with the mayor. They have equipped themselves. Possibly they had these in their car, maybe. You know, not the craziest part of this movie. He has an M16 and he has a harpoon gun that he got from the pawn shop. This is also a very crazy scene because out of nowhere pops this guy. Just to let you know, this is actually Gary, but it's the same actor as Gary, should I say, but he's wearing a mask. This is actually just a delivery guy who just came out of the corn. Apparently, Jonathan ordered something on amazing.com. Definitely not Amazon. Apparently, it's a 4-hour shipping. He got some shark repellent bracelets sent. Also, when the delivery guy goes in the cornfield, he immediately dies to sharks. So, you know, as you do. He offers a shark repellent bracelet to the mayor. The mayor's like, nah, it's fine. You got one. So let's see how that goes. Next, we're back here with these three. They've finally made it to Druid Hills, where the cornfield is. Teddy explains to them that there will be a ritual tonight where they will summon the shark goddess Chichi Matu, I think is how you pronounce it. And Benchley's like, okay, we're gonna have to kill all the sharks in the corn. Let's do. And then Constable Scheider's like, oh, I got some stuff in the back. Go check it out. As he's looking through the bag, there's another sly peaceful protest joke in there. And as he's going through there, Scheider decides to hit him in the back of the head with a brick. What? Why would she do that? Well, it comes one of the biggest twists of the movie. She's part of the shark cult. Should have seen it coming. So, yes, she's part of the shark cult. And she's going to work together with this guy because she wants the shark. She asks if the shark goddess can bring Lorna back to life. Despite the fact that this is the guy that killed her sister, she's going to work with him. Okay, that's fun. Now we move back into the cornfield with good old Mayor and Jonathan. Unfortunately for him, the mayor does get taken out because he wasn't wearing the shark repellent bracelet, but Jonathan does get saved. It does work, apparently. Where do I buy one of these? Next, we're in the cornfield here with Teddy and Shida. They're starting the ritual. Teddy tells her that she must wear the scarecrow's outfit with the shark head and the plaid shirt. It's all part of the ritual, obviously. Yes, I could see exactly why she needs to do this. yeah, good. Solid stuff. Now, Benchley has woken up and is making his way towards the cornfield. As he looks up, he sees the helicopter that have the Mafia Dons. But unfortunately for the Mafia Dons, they flew over the shark cornfield. And I don't know if you can guess this. This is probably one of the better scenes of the movie. But the shark flies out and destroys the helicopter. Like, of course it did. after seeing that, Jonathan runs out of the cornfield, bumps into Benchley. They decide to band together. They exchange stories. And Jonathan gives him one of his shark repellent bracelets. And they're going to work together to stop the sharks. As they make their way into the corn, they come across Teddy, who is doing the shark ritual. He is calling onto the Stonehenge, the Blood Moon, and all that to summon Chichi Matu. The ritual is a success. He pours the shark juice into the water and pours it in the floor with the shark embryo or whatever. And then we get a transformation here. We get the shark goddess. So Shida becomes the shark goddess. And then now Teddy also becomes the protector of the shark goddess. I don't know, squid guy. He's just called the protector. And now we're fucked, right? Like, there's nothing you can do here. Like, there's been summoned. The ritual's done. They've got the shark. They got the protector. We've got the shark goddess. What are we going to do now? Like, there's nothing that Jonathan and Benchley can do unless some sort of miracle happened. Like, I don't know, maybe Sasquatch comes out from the back and RKO's the protector. Yes. That's the best fucking 5 minutes of the movie happens. He comes in with a big fucking boulder, smashes him in the back of the head, and then runs away. Thank you, Sasquatch. You are the best. Next, Jonathan just making sure that the protector is dead, because, you know, giant boulders to the back of the head. We don't know if that's going to kill the protector. Let's just make sure. Jonathan decides to shoot his harpoon gun. And when I say shoot, I mean daintily throw the harpoon at the protector on the ground. Yep, he's dead. Good. But what about the shark goddess? How are we going to take her out? You know what I mean? We've used Sasquatch. We've used the spear. What do we have left? Let's think. It's got to be Benchley. What's Benchley going to do? He decides to run past the shark goddess and dunk a grenade into her crown whilst saying the best line of the movie, "Take this grenade, bitch," and then runs away. No, I can't make this up. These are real things that happened in this movie. The grenade promptly explodes and blows off her head. And there we go. We have one. We've been the protector. We've been the shark goddess. Apparently, there's no more sharks in the corn anymore. We have one. Good job, Jonathan. Good job, Benchley. Everyone is happy now. Or are they? The very end of the movie, Benchley and Jonathan get attacked by people of the shark cult, and that's the end of the movie there. Thank you very much, guys. That was a roller coaster. Stephen King's Sharks of the Corn. Like, it's insane. What happened in this movie is insane. Like, I know it's I don't think it's taking itself too seriously. I think it's supposed to be like a parody. But what a beautiful, absolute great movie. I do recommend watching it. Let's give it, I give it 8 sharks out of 10. And that's it for Liam's terrible movie review. If you liked the movie, let me know. Write a comment below. If you enjoy this video, like the video. Also, don't forget to subscribe to my Twitch. I stream Tuesday, Thursday, Fridays. There we go. Have a great day, guys. And that'll be all for me. Peace.
I am going to Kermit suicide.
What? Guy just ran me under a train.